Hey guys, today I have a phenomenal vet bringback story for you. And because of the fact that we just went through D-Day, June 6th, 1944, we remembered that just a couple days ago. But I moved this video to the head of the line, meaning this gun just came in and I have like three or four guns ahead of it. But because of the connection to D-Day and a very special battle on D-Day, I wanted to move this up in the line. I'm going to read you the story from his nephew and then show you the gun. The man's name is Bradley, Carl Bradley, and this is the gun that he captured from a German officer on D-Day. So this note is written by William Anderson, who's 72 years old, lives in Tampa, Florida, about his uncle, Carl Bradley. Now, he took the time to write actually a four-page letter. I'm going to read excerpts, actually most of it, skip a few parts, but I want to read through it because he took the time to type this all out, and we commend him for doing that. He gives a lot of detail about the story, a story about Pointe Du Hoc. For those of you who watch The Longest Day or Saving Private Ryan or any documentary about D-Day, you know about Pointe Du Hoc. Those were the cliffs overlooking the beaches of Normandy, and the U.S. Army Rangers, along with British commandos, went in before the sun came up. So they were the first one on the beaches. I do know about the paratroopers landing behind enemy lines. In fact, we just did a special video, check it out. Memorial Day, we commemorated Captain Dick Winters and the efforts that he made on D-Day to parachute behind enemy lines. But check that video out, well worth it. In this one, we're talking about the Army Rangers who climbed the cliffs of Pointe Du Hoc to take out the gun emplacements that were on top. So I'm going to read you a recounting of the story from the veteran Carl Bradley and also tie it into the gun that he brought home. This is how William Anderson starts the letter. It is my distinct privilege and honor to provide this account of how my uncle, Carl Bradley, came into the possession of this 1934 7.65 German Navy officer pistol. Yeah, a little quirk in there. Pay attention. Only on rare occasions, mostly when it was just the two of us, Carl would share his experiences of serving in the United States Army during World War II. Carl volunteered to join the Army sometime prior to D-Day. Quickly, the U.S. Army discovered his physical abilities as well as his uncanny lack of fear. He was sent for special training and joined a new division of the Army called the Army Rangers. This placed him in a position that would lead him to coming into the possession of this German Navy pistol. My uncle found himself and his unit of Army Rangers cut out from the others. No one seemed to know why or where they would be going. A few weeks later, he found himself and his unit in England, in an area that was far from any inhabited villages or towns. His unit were the only Americans anywhere around. The remote and clandestine camp was inhabited by British Army commandos. The units were merged into smaller units consisting half U.S. Army Rangers and half British commandos. In the beginning, they did not mix very well. To quell the squabbling, the troops trained regularly, scheduled boxing matches as a way to work out some of their differences. Sounds like my brother and I growing up. That worked out fairly well, but what worked the most was when they learned the nature of their classified mission, the heavy weight of responsibility, and how tens of thousands of lives would depend on their success quickly melted the Rangers and commandos into lockstep professional do-or-die mission. Past this junction, Carl shared that there were no more disagreements and that they merged into being best of friends for life. Carl shared that their mission was one that was simple to state but near impossible to accomplish. The mixed units of Rangers and Commandos would be the first to invade the coastline defenses on D-Day. The target of the mission was to scale the cliffs, breach the coastal cannon barrier defenses, and neutralize them. D-Day approached, and the mixed units of U.S. Army Rangers and British Commandos were the first to depart the safety of the British coast. Unlike the larger vessels that the regular troops were boarding, the special Ranger Commando units were carried in small fishing vessels. The small vessels were more difficult for the German sentries to spot. Also, the smaller vessels were quieter and could move closer to the shore along the shallow, shoaled coastline. The foul weather and darkness on D-Day helped to conceal them, and none were spotted or engaged in any way. The landing would be the most difficult of all those made on D-Day. It would be made in total darkness, before sunrise, and in the midst of foul weather. Once gathered, the troops focused their next objective, which would take them to scale the cliffs below the cannon emplacements. They prepared for their climb and attached lines to explosives and other equipment that would be hauled up behind them. It was critical that this climb be accomplished before the main invasion force near the coast. Also, their mission plan hinged on the climb being completely in the dark before the first light to reduce the possibility of detection. Carl shared with me that the climb was what they all feared the most. As the Ranger Commando units scaled the cliffs, the mission required it be done silently. Carl shared that it was almost impossible to make the climb without any noise at all being made. If the Germans detected them and put all of the coastal defenses on high alert, they would blow the element of surprise and that all of D-Day was built upon. Carl hunkered silently in position, as did every man. Each man was responsible for the lives of all the others. The Ranger Commando units had been well trained for this very moment, and they did their jobs as planned. Silently, every man and all the explosives, ammunition, and equipment had been hauled up by hand. The final stage of the assault was now ready. As one can well understand, my Uncle Carl had some areas where his memories didn't serve him well. The fog of war, especially close quarter combat, can make the memories difficult to retrieve over time. I often recall Carl pausing at this part of the story. He would just sit there with a blank stare. He was a very intelligent man and well-spoken, and being at a loss for words was not something that happened very often. However, at this part, he would always go silent for a few minutes. Sometimes while silent, he would just look down at his hands and stare while rubbing them softly together. Carl's account of the taking of the German coastal battery would always lurch forward to the end result. His unit was able to accomplish their mission and take out the German battery. Now, not in this story, but I know from watching historical records, when they got to the top of the cliffs, the battery was gone. The large guns had been moved, and they actually followed the drag marks. I don't remember, it was probably a mile or two inland. Some of you will correct me on that. But they dragged the battery further inland, and that's where the Army Rangers and Commandos found them, and they used their explosive satchels to destroy all of the German batteries. Carl and his unit also had a special assignment, which was to capture German officers. Carl captured and disarmed a young German Navy officer who was in charge of one of the batteries. It happened that he was the only surviving German officer of that particular installment. Carl removed his pistol from his belt and secured it. Carl assured the German naval officer that he would not be harmed if he would stay calm and did not try to escape or fight them. Here is where Carl shared that he thought that he had a pretty good insight on what was going on in the young German officer's mind and emotions. Carl shared that the officer had been completely taken by surprise. He was asleep on a cot with thick walls of concrete bunker. He had been asleep one moment and then awoke with a knife at his throat. The planned surprise attack took the opportunity to fight away from him. The special months of training and practice had paid off. But now the German officer was in a state of fear and confusion. The German officer had been trained and had been ready to aim his cannons on the invading Allied ships and to sink them and to kill as many Allied troops as possible. That opportunity had been stolen from him by Carl and his unit. Carl shared that the early hours of D-Day were filled with chaos and confusion. His unit's mission had been accomplished perfectly, but the invading Allied troops on the beaches were being slaughtered. Carl did recount that it would have been much worse if the German coastal batteries had not been silenced. However, between the great spaces of cannon, there was also other batteries, mortars, field cannon, machine gun nests that rained down terror on the invading Allied troops. The mission called for Carl's unit to neutralize, secure, and hold the coastal batteries. Carl's special assignment had been to capture, secure, and hold German officers. He would have to remain in place protecting his captured officer until the Allied troops arrived, who were assigned to gather up the German officers and take them back for interrogation. Carl held his position for close to 18 hours before troops came to take the German officer. Carl had seen how utterly defeated, confused, and afraid the young German officer had been since his capture. He also noticed, as he prepared his rations, that the young officer was very curious and appeared to be hungry. Carl offered him some canned meat. The officer accepted, and for the first time, the two shared a smile with each other. Once the meal had been consumed, Carl reached into his top pocket and pulled out a Hershey chocolate bar. All of the Commando Ranger units had carried a German Hershey chocolate in their top right pocket. It was there as a quick source of energy if needed during the assault. Carl hadn't touched his. With his signature friendly smile, Carl handed the Hershey bar to the young German Navy officer. For the second time, Carl and the young officer exchanged smiles. Carl added here that after taking the first bite, the young German officer laughed and thanked him. As the day after D-Day neared, the expected Allied troops appeared and took custody of the young German officer. The American officer in charge of the Allied troops asked to gather up all of the captured officers along with their weapons. He stated that the weapons were to be taken along to interrogation. Carl picked up his rucksack in which he had secured the officer's pistol and began to pull it out, but the young German officer stopped him. He told Carl that he wanted him to keep it and that he knew it would be in good hands. Carl stated that the Allied officer who asked for the weapons said something flippant and told Carl, "Oh, forget it," and proceeded to walk away. The young German officer went off to the interrogation post. So let me push pause here just for a minute, because after we were all done this video, we heard again from family members who gave us new information. This photo here is actually a famous photo, and they indicated that this man right here is their uncle, Sergeant John Carl Bradley. He's running down the hill to rejoin his crew, his group, right after he turned over the German naval officer, and he claims, or family members claim, that this officer, German officer right above him, the one without the hat, without a helmet, is actually the naval officer he took this Mauser from. So he captured it from this naval officer. Carl had just turned him over to the army officers, the interrogation officers that were taking him back to camp. But family members claim that this most likely was the German officer that he took the pistol from. Carl left the Mauser 1934 to me in his will. As fate has it, I only have daughters and they have no interest in keeping this in the family. After much deliberation, I decided it should be held in the possession of someone who would really appreciate the remarkable craftsmanship as well as the human events and the history associated with it. Considering that as honorable and something Carl would have been pleased with, I contacted Legacy Collectibles and offered them the Mauser 1934, taken from the young German Navy officer. I trust that they will find a new perfect custodian for this unique and prized World War II trophy acquired on D-Day by Carl Bradley. My signature below attests to the accuracy of the information above, as told to me by my dear beloved Uncle Sergeant John Carl Bradley. And here you see his signature on the letter, but he's not done. He says, P.S. And I did ask this when I heard the story. P.S. Some may ask, what would a young German naval officer be doing on shore at a coastal cannon battery on D-Day? The answer is that the large cannons installed into the German coastal defense system were originally designed and manufactured for installment onto German naval battleships. By 1944, they didn't have any more battleships. All they had was U-boats, and certainly these large cannon would not fit in a U-boat. So I believe he's right. So he said that these were intended to go on battleships, but of course there were no more battleships, so they used them for the defense at Normandy. The German army had no training, knowledge, or experience in such weapons. Therefore, the officers in charge of the coastal cannon batteries came from the German Navy, as did the cannon battery crews. I have to agree. I think he's right. So let's take a look at the gun. I know you're dying to see it. Let's take a look. So first and foremost, this is the holster. We do see a lot of these. I've probably sold 30 or 40 of them. This is considered a Navy style, just the way the closure strap works, and the brown would be a Navy color. Sometimes they'll have a Navy marking on this side here or here. Also under here, there might be one, or here. This one does not have a Navy marking. And Randy is very clever, so I'll ask him pop up a picture of one with a Navy marking. So we have had them with Navy markings before. This one does not have the Navy marking. It does say Bradley. Evidently, it was Sergeant John Carl Bradley, because that's how he signed it at the end, how he gave his name at the end. So that came like that. Here is the gun itself, and there is a spare magazine. We'll get that out of the way. That's a Mauser magazine. That's correct for a 1934. I'll set those aside, and now we'll focus on the gun itself. These do come with a one-piece wooden grip. It's very well fitted. All the ones that I've seen, the craftsmanship is very good, very well fitted. So it's a one-piece grip, much like the PPK. It is a model 1934, comes in 7.65. And what makes the Navy ones distinct, I was about to say extinct, I hope this never becomes extinct, but instead remains distinct. There you see the Navy marking. Now, these were individually engraved. I love this gun because of the story, and I do believe the story. Now, if you're a snarky individual and you want to write in the comments, total BS, I don't believe a word of it, I have a suggestion. If you don't like it, move on. You're not going to buy the gun. You don't need to watch the video. Just go away. I'm here to honor the vets and the people who sacrificed so much for our freedoms. And if he says this is a gun that he brought home, I believe him. Yes, there probably are some memories that are a little bit distorted or not quite accurate. But let me tell you, when I tell a story that happened 2 weeks ago, it changes quite a bit. But back to the marking. We do see different styles. Here's one. There is a closed wing eagle. That's one style. This is the earlier style, which is considered a straight wing eagle. And whenever we sell one of these, somebody says, I have one and the swastika is a little smaller, or I have one and the M is a little bit larger. I do know that they are faked. And I do know that if you have an engraving machine, you can make this mark with practice or with the right equipment. However, these were individually inscribed, and they did come in different sizes and shapes, but generally, all of the stick wing eagles look about like this, and the closed wing eagles looked about like this. The ones that came from the East Sea, or the keel base, will be O property marked, and you can see one here. The one that went to the North Sea, or Wilhelmshaven, had the N property mark. And here you see the N property mark. So we know that this officer, this German officer, came out of Wilhelmshaven, which is in northern Germany. And also, we see that it has the original matching magazine. Now, it is hard to see. This is engraved over the finish. But what you should see is rust, because the bare metal would rust. And you do see it's like a reddish rust, matching end property mark, and over the finish with rust over top of it. If it's brand new, it'll be shiny metal. But in this case, you can see that it has been aged, and it does come with one matching magazine, a spare magazine, and also a proper Navy style holster. I hope you enjoyed today's vet bringback story, very special for the D-Day and the Army Ranger significance. We did ask for pictures, but he didn't have any available. I especially want to thank William Anderson of Tampa, Florida, for taking the time to write out this story. This story needed to be told, and there's still vets alive. We need to get as many stories as we possibly can. But thank you for taking the time to write all this out. And thank you especially for your family treasures and passing them along to us. I assure you, we will be good custodians and honor the memory of your uncle.